حبك يا رسول الله حبا تغلغل في الجوارح والفؤاد.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله إمام الخلق والمرسلين صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. Well, if anyone here has been following the news lately, we've heard a lot about Gaza or Gaza and what's happening in Gaza. We've heard a lot about our brothers and sisters being bombarded day and night. Men, women, children, elderly, even the disabled were bombed. And ikhwani, the more I think about it, the more I think about it, and it reminds me of Syria and what's happening in Syria. And then the more I think about Syria, it reminds me of what's happening in Burma, where they're burning our brothers and sisters alive. Then the more I think about that, it reminds me of what's happening in Middle Africa and certain parts of Africa, where they're killing and stabbing our brothers and burning them again. And subhanAllah, the more I think about it and I study the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I realize the problem, ikhwani, is not a single-handed problem in Palestine or a single-handed problem in Syria or in Burma or in Africa. It is a constant battle between haq and batil. That's what's happening. Yes, on the outside of it, or from the, yani from looking at it from a far away, or yani from a yani from a simplistic way, we see that the Israelis are bombing our yani harmless Palestinian brothers, or our brothers who could hardly defend themselves. That's what we see. But it is a fight between haq and batil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a whole surah in the Quran that talks about the fight between haq and batil, truth and falsehood. One of the surah in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this extensively is a surah by the name of Surah Al-A'raf. It's a beautiful surah. It talks about so many messengers and prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It talks about so many incidents that has happened. It talks about so many different things. However, if we look at the meaning of the A'raf, this surah, which is about 206 or 208 verses, if we look at the meaning and the purpose of this surah, it actually talks about a group of people. Ashab al-A'raf or Ahlul al-A'raf. Who are they, ikhwani? These people are Muslims who come on the Day of Judgment where the hasanat have equaled their sayyat. Remember the struggle between haq and batil? Now the struggle between haq and batil, truth and falsehood, is over your hasanat and sayyat, over your own deeds, over your own heart. If a person comes on the Day of Judgment and their good deeds are equivalent to their bad deeds, they become a person or from the people of Al-A'raf. Who are these people? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the people of Jannah to enter Jannah and the people of Hellfire to be taken to Hellfire, a group of people remain behind. It's the people of the A'raf. They are literally placed in a wall or in a section between Jannah and Jahannam, heaven and hell. They look at the people of Jannah, and the people of Jannah are enjoying the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're enjoying Jannah. They're enjoying their hur. They're enjoying their houses, their rivers, being with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, being with the companions, doing everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed them to do in Jannah. Then they turn their eyes to look towards the people of Jahannam. And forgive me for looking this way, it just happens I look this way. They look towards the people of Jahannam and see the people being tortured in Jahannam. See the people being burnt. See the people being, you know, and the list goes on. And we all know what happens in Jahannam. Let us go back a few steps, ikhwani. Imagine yourself coming on the Day of Judgment. Your dad, your mother, your brother, your sister, your family are all taken to Jannah. Bi'idhnillah Azza wa Jal. And then your turn comes and your deeds are placed on the scale. Here's your hasanat and here's your sayyat. And the scale does not leave a thing. It does not leave a single thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with you very generously on that day. And here's the scale and here's your deeds. And your hasanat and your sayyat, your good deeds and your bad deeds are what? Equivalent. Equal. How do you feel? How do you feel knowing that a hasana today, for you to earn a hasana, Outside the month of Ramadan, all you have to say is Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah alone. Just one Subhanallah. Just to say, oh Allah, I praise you. Alhamdulillah, oh Allah, thank you. Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, and so on. Allahu Akbar, Allah is equivalent to 10 hasanat. So what's a hasana? What's a hasana? If you donate, it's a hasana which goes to 10 hasanat, which goes to 700 hasanat. Wallahu yudha'ifu liman yasha, Allah increases to the ones that He wants. What's a hasana? What's a good deed? A good deed that can make you stay between Jannah and Jahannam, possibly for eternity. A good deed, just one good deed, ikhwani. You know what that good deed is? Maybe when the Imam was praying, you didn't have khushu' and you pushed yourself to have khushu'. Maybe as you're walking out of here, you looked in your pocket, there's nothing in your pocket, there's only a dollar. You threw that dollar in that donation box. Maybe you see a brother that you haven't seen for a while, or you don't know this brother, or whatever the case may be, you just shook his hands and smiled at his face for the sake of Allah. Ahsana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Zalzala, at the end of the surah, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. What's مِثْقَالُ ذَرَّةٍ? Whoever does an atom weight of good shall see. Where is he going to see it? On that day, when all your deeds are brought forward, all your good deeds are placed on one side of the scale, and all your bad deeds are placed on the other side of the scale. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. You'll see that good deed. And the one that does an atom weight of bad will also say on that day. Ikhwani, I'll say this, as unfortunately, as I travel between Masajid and Musallas, etc., and I'm seeing numbers decrease, what? In the month of Ramadan, the month of Khayr, the month of Hasanat, the month of doing good, the month where a call from Allah says, Ya Baghi al-Khayri Aqbil, oh, the one who wants to do good, come. And the one who wants to do bad, go away. This is a month of doing good, and we find that the mosques are empty. This is a month where your sunnah prayer, or your extra prayer, your tawakh prayer, etc., is equivalent to a fard outside the month of Ramadan. And your fard prayer is equivalent to 70 fard. This is a month where a donation gets elevated by Allah so much that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you on it in plentiful. This is a month where fasting a day in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to the equivalent of you being protected from hellfire for 70 years. And the list goes on. But we find people being lazy. What is it? Why are we complacent? Well, how can you get lazy when you know that hellfire is being prepared and Jannah is being prepared? Which way you want to go? Have you been guaranteed Jannah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once was praying at night. And Aisha radiallahu anha told him, Ya Rasulullah, you're praying all night. Let me describe to you how he was praying. He was praying and he started to cry. Then he was standing and he was crying. Then he went into ruku' and what happened? He started to cry more. He wept and wept, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he went into sujood and he wept even more and more, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he kept weeping all night. This is a man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all his sins. This is a man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed Jannah. This is a man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared al-firdaus for him. This is a man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him Jannah. He was weeping all night. So when Aisha radiallahu anhu asked him, Ya Rasulullah, you've been forgiven all your sins. Listen to what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shouldn't I be a thankful slave? This is the man that Allah forgave all his sins. What about me and you? Aren't we more in need of that forgiveness than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Are we more in need of that forgiveness than Umar radiallahu anhu? The man that his daughter once came up to and told him, Ya Umar, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, our father, I do not see you sleep. So he said, Ya Binti, daughter, how can I sleep? If I sleep during the day, I neglect the Ummah. He was a Khalifa of the Muslims. And he needed to give all his time for the Ummah throughout the day. And if I sleep at night, I neglect myself. Anna anam. Kayfa anam. Where am I going to sleep? How am I going to find time to sleep? إخواني, understand this, the Ramadan syndrome. When you start, you're fresh, you're strong, you start reciting Quran at the beginning of the month, you have all these timetables and you plan and you want to do so much, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from you. And the month starts and you may not kick your goals at the beginning. Or you may kick your goals and then you became lazy. You become lazy, etc. Whenever that happens to you, and it happens to me, and it happens to everyone, Ikhwani. Whenever it happens to you, just remind yourself of your ultimate goal. Why are you here? You're here to enter that Jannah. Why are you worshipping Allah? To enter that Jannah. To be saved from that hellfire. Put Jannah as your ultimate goal and push yourself towards that Jannah. If you find yourself, you need tawheed, not tawheed. You need to be sort of scared, not, encouraged. Then remind yourself of hellfire behind you. I'll finish off with one of the companions, radiallahu anhu, who used this strategy and it worked. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once in a gathering. In one of the battles, and he was sort of talking about the matters of war. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was facing the audience, when all of a sudden, one of the kuffar was amongst the Muslims, and he was listening and tuning in to what, the war plans were, and what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was saying, what the Muslims are planning. It was a war gathering. So this kafir, the Prophet is facing the companions, and they're facing him. This kafir was sort of, towards the end of the lines. He could hear the Prophet. Then he heard what he wanted. He sort of creeped away slowly, jumped on a horse and raced. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam realized there was a spy. So he said, "Man yudrik al-faris wa lahu al-jannah." Who will catch that knight and Jannah is his? The moment the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam said that word, three companions radiallahu anhum raced. One of them jumped on a camel and started to race this spy. The second man jumped on a mule, it's between a donkey and a horse, and he started to chase this spy. And the third companion who I'm talking about tonight, inshallah, by the name of Salama ibn al-Aqwa, he started running. So one of the companions told Salama ibn al-Aqwa, "Habibi, where are you going? You're running. A man's on a horse. Imagine we have a Ferrari, we have a, something less than Ferrari, a Merc, we have a Toyota Camry, Allah istu alayna, and we have someone running." So that one of the companions saw the man running, "Habibi, the guy's in a Ferrari, where are you going? The man on the camel might have a chance, the man on the mule might have a chance, you're running." He told him, "Walakinni sami'tu Rasulullah yaqulu al-jannah." But I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say what? Jannah! And that's why you're here tonight. That's why tonight, when you go home and you're tired, and you're lethargic and all that, remind yourself of what? Jannah. When you wake up for suhoor and it's 4 a.m. and you think, who the heck wakes up at 4 a.m. to eat? Remind yourself of Jannah. That's why whatever happens to you, you get lazy, you get complacent, somebody annoys you, you remind yourself of what? Jannah. Jannah, ikhwan. So the companion of the Allah began to run. And he started racing. He said, "Fakhara Quwai, I lost all my energy." And he's a human being running after people and animals. So he said, "Walakinni tadhakkartu al-jannah." But I reminded myself of Jannah. So I beat the man in the mule. So imagine you're on the mule and this man beats you. So now he kept running. He goes, "I lost all my energy. Walakinni tadhakkartu al-jannah." Then I remind myself of Jannah. So I beat the man on the camel. Imagine how fast was he running. He was running for it. Running, racing. To beat a man on a camel. Camel go pretty fast, mashallah. He raced and he beat the man on the camel. Then he goes, "Fakharat kawai, farajaraytu ajarat." I kept running, but Allah saw my energy. But I reminded myself of Jannah, so I kept running and running and running up until I caught the man off the horse. Well, what pushed him? What was the fuel? Jannah. Khwan, you're going to feel tired. I guarantee you. You're going to be sleepy. You're going to be hungry. You're going to be lethargic. You're going to feel so many different things. Remember the people of the Araf. One hasana, one good deed. One good deed, ikhwani. One subhanallah, one alhamdulillah. One dollar in donations, one dua. One letter from the Quran being recited. One whatever it is. Could have made them from the people of Jannah. And that's what you want to be. From the people of what? Jannah. May Allah make us all from the people of Jannah. May Allah gather us all in Jannah.